All right, there's no avoiding it. Thanks for coming along, everyone. You having a good tech ed so far?
Yeah.
Someone is having an awesome tech ed. It's only going to get better, at least for the next hour and a quarter. Then it goes downhill again. We're going to spend the next hour or so doing a thing that we call UX clinics. This is a thing we do for our clients from time to time. And basically it's a sort of rapid, very sort of ad hoc and ad scripted UX review, user experience review for applications. Generally when we're working with our clients we do this, we usually set aside a day. Oftentimes, it's the first time we've ever met with our clients. We literally show up knowing almost nothing about what it is we're going to look at. We get taken through the application and the business objectives of the application. We then sort of walk through the user interface. We start to tease it apart, and towards the end of the day, we start to look at two things: ways that the user experience or the user interface as it exists can be improved. And we also talk about actions going forward, so stuff that the project team might want to do sort of going forward. Some of our clients, we do this clinic on a regular basis, maybe once a month. We show up for a day and sort of review the state of the user interface at the time. And we also, at the same time, we're trying to, that's our job, to sort of transfer across what we know about user interface design to the client. So it's kind of a way to sort of learn on the job, I guess. We also do shorter versions of this, including sort of one-hour versions of this, where we meet up with folks who've got an app, usually smaller apps like phone apps and stuff like that, and we just do this over an hour. Not saying that we fix every problem in an hour, not by any means, but usually we can spot a few things that need addressing, sometimes we leave that to the patient to deal with. Sometimes we can help out going forward. So what I thought I'd do this year is basically try to reproduce that clinic, but teeny tiny. We're going to have a look at four apps today, so we've got basically 15 minutes per app. We've got some brave volunteers who've offered to put their apps up for review today. We've got two phone apps, and we've got two web apps to look at. I'll tell you what those are in a sec. The reason I wanted to do this is not is as much as anything to sort of share with you guys how we think about user experience and how we sort of approach a review of an existing UI. I think when I've spoken at TechEd in the past, I've done a bunch of sort of, more or less theoretical talks about this is how you should do it and this is, the perfect world. So I wanted this year to do something a little bit more practical that required no preparation. I've done a little preparation. But I did want to sort of just expose to you guys, and I thought it'd be fun if we literally did it completely unscripted. So I've seen Ed's app I just saw for the first time. Troy's app I had a little look at yesterday on the plane. The two phone apps I've had a little play with as well, but pretty much I don't know much about these apps and we're all going to explore them together. So I'm probably supposed to have talked to some slides by now. So this is something that we get to do a lot as part of our work, and it goes like this. I'm here to tell you your baby is ugly. You'd think it would be fun, right? We all love to criticise. But we try to be a little bit more positive, a little bit more positive than that. But certainly the clients who engage us for these clinics, we try to prepare them for, there's no point us, being polite. We're going to tell it like it is. I guess the thing to bear in mind though is, particularly when we come in cold to these sorts of engagements, is what we don't have, and I'll come back to this later, is we don't have a lot of business background. We don't know a lot about your audience, what you're trying to achieve, how you want them to change their behaviour, what you want them to do. And so when we do these reviews, we tend to have to review them from the point of view of a standard sort of set of heuristics or guidelines, you know, that what makes good UI. But of course, what really makes good UI is making sure that you have a UI that's specific to your audience and specific to their needs and your business needs. So while we won't be able to get very far into that today, we'll chat a little bit about that as we go. So I don't want to give you a bunch of slideware, but you know, at the very highest level, I guess when we do these reviews, we're sort of looking for four things, and the obvious one is it usable? You know, is it easy to use? Sometimes that also means is it easy to learn? Oftentimes we have to talk to the clients first about what is the definition of usable for your application, because if you've got it writing an application that's going to be used by staff sitting at a desk 8 hours a day, then learnable is possibly not the most important usability goal. Efficiency or error prevention is probably more important. Compare that to an app that people are going to walk up to and use once, like a kiosk app, where learnability is way more important than efficiency, because they need to start being productive immediately. Whereas if you've got an app that people are going to be using a lot, you might actually sacrifice some of that learnability to optimize for performance going forward. So usable is the obvious one. You know, we also, it's not just our job, but you know, we also ask ourselves, is this application actually useful? Does it serve a purpose that makes sense to users? And of course, to do that, we need to understand a little bit about users. I'll talk about that in a sec. Is it engaging? You know, and that's our catch-all phrase for do people like, or will people like using this? And the definition of engaging, you know, will vary. If you're writing a game, we're going to look at Andrew Coates' Find a Word game in a minute, then, you know, engaging for that, you know, literally means about being immersive and captured in the moment and, you know, maybe, you know, a little bit addictive even. But when we look at a very practical application, like we're going to look at Troy's, how do I say that, Troy? Do I just say a safer web?
Beautiful.
So we're going to look at Troy's A Safer Web website, which, you know, is not about having fun. It's about website security, as far as I can gather. Don't know much about these things. And so engaging for a site like that would be very different to engaging for a game. And the last thing is effective. Does it meet the business goals? Because what's really interesting is that often when you're designing an app, your users' goals and your business's goals don't line up. Sometimes they do, but sometimes they're completely at odds. You know, if you're doing a classified ad type application, then you, from a business point of view, you want to sell premium and advertising, say, let's just say that. As a consumer of that app, you possibly actually are not interested in premium and advertising. You will sort of want, maybe you want a more of a level playing field. And so you can see how, when you think about your application, what you want to achieve and what users want to achieve with your application don't always line up. So while our focus, of course, is whether users can and will achieve what they want to achieve when they use your application or your site, the flip side of that is, at the same time, is it actually meeting a business goal? And are we finding the right sweet spot where we match those things up? Just a little bit more slide where every year at TechEd I trot out this diagram. When we talk about user experience design, a lot of people think we're talking about visual design, and to be honest, we'll talk a lot about visual design today. But the user experience, and why we say user interface, user experience rather than user interface, is sort of encapsulates the end-to-end journey that a user will have discovering, using, reusing, recommending your application. And so we can sort of talk about it in four layers. At the top and the starting point is the proposition. What is it that you're going to offer to the market? What is the thing that you are making and why do you think it's valuable? Then we usually worry about information design. How is information structured and organized across pages or screens? The reason we focus on that first is, firstly, it's the hardest thing to get right and it's the most expensive thing to fix if you get it wrong. So after conceptual design, we tend to focus on information design. And that comes out in, you know, workflow diagrams and site maps and, you know, the sorts of materials that you've seen before where you're sort of starting to plan out how your application hangs together. Interaction design refers to the selection of controls and allowing users to actually poke at things and read information back and use the app for real. And once we've worked out how we're going to distribute content and functionality, we can then work out how we're going to let users interact with it. And then finally comes the visual design. And the reason visual design comes last is because it has a lot of work to do. When we do visual design, we're not just making the app look pretty, but we're also communicating all the work we've done up here, because the visual design, the pixels that you place on the screen, have to communicate what you can do and how you can do it, where you are and where you can go, and what the heck this app is for and why you'd like it. So visual design has to do a lot of work. And I think oftentimes we think that, you know, it's just about making the app pretty. Oftentimes we think that visual design is just a layer that happens on the end. And I know in this diagram I'm suggesting that you start here and you end there, but you don't do visual design in isolation. The visual design is informed by all the work that's happened beforehand. So we're going to look at four different types of UX review. And I've kind of done this so that we can sort of focus it on UX review from different perspectives. I don't necessarily know that I want you guys to go away thinking, right, there's four different types of review we have to do when we get back to work. But I'm going to, for the four apps, I'm going to sort of approach it using four different sort of lenses, or then you could call them techniques, but I don't really want to be that obsessive about it. Expert review is exactly what it sounds like. Some expert, today that'll be me, looking at an application and from, on the basis of experience, pointing out potential issues. Heuristic review is kind of similar, but we use a sort of a checklist of good design guidelines, and we use that checklist to kind of remind us to make sure that we're looking at this aspect, or we're looking at that aspect. Cognitive walkthrough sounds scary. It's actually pretty simple, but what it focuses on is whether users can find their way from one step to another through the process of using your application. So it focuses on end-to-end workflow, and we'll see how that works in a minute. And then the last one is a usability test, which is the term we use for when the expert steps aside and we let a real user use the application, and what we do is we observe the real user using the application. So we'll have a look at how that works towards the end. So we've got about 15 minutes per technique, and we've got four apps to go through. First, we're going to have a look at AU Weather Pro Niall Ginsberg down in Melbourne, and I told him I'd have him on Skype in case we need to chat to him. So let me just fire up Skype. Please be online. All right, we'll come back to that. Let me just turn on internet sharing. Oh, it's recovered? Okay, cool. Thank you, buddy. Where is he? All right, he's supposedly online, but he's not saying anything. We're going to have a look at AU Weather Pro, which is a Windows Phone app. Niles tells me that he's done a few revisions of this app. He's now starting to think about how it's going to translate to Windows 8. So he kindly volunteered for us to have a look at that app together. Does anyone, this is a really popular app, so I imagine at least some people here use it, yeah? Cool, awesome. We might get your feedback as well. Then we're going to switch to the web, and Troy's volunteered a saferweb.com, which is an automatic security analyzer for ASP.NET websites. Don't ask me how I know that. I read it off the slide. So he's going to take us through that, and we'll do the sort of heuristic review for that one. Then Ed's going to volunteer. They've got a light switch app that's to do with consignment delivery, and in particular, we're going to look at a little app that is about confirming that stuff has been delivered to a store. And then lastly, we'll have a look at Andrew Coates's Find a Word app, which is a little Windows Phone game that he's kindly volunteered for us to have a look at. Andrew was going to be here today, but unfortunately, he's got some family business, some unexpected family business that he has to attend to today. So we're going to muddle on without him. So that's the plan. Let's get moving. we start by asking ourselves, when we go to do these reviews, we start by asking, you know, what is it that we're trying to review against? In other words, what are your goals or objectives? Oftentimes I get asked by clients, could you have a look at our design and tell me what you think? And I'm like, well, yes, but first let's talk about who are the users, why are they here, what are they trying to achieve, how are you trying to change their behaviour, or what is it that you're trying to help them to do, and even how do we want them to feel about using your application. So we can't really measure the user experience of any one application unless we've got something to measure it against. Oftentimes these goals, we state them much more formally, but in the UX clinics, we basically just have a little bit of a brainstorm about these sorts of questions, and we'll talk a little bit about, particularly with Troy and Ed, since they're in the room, about those things as we go. Excuse me, frog in the throat. Microsoft, particularly in the Windows 8 design guidance, says that we should start with a great at statement, that we should start by saying what our app is great at. And it's their way of suggesting that we should think about what's going to differentiate our application, what's going to be the sort of the key feature, or not feature of it, the key benefit of it. And they tell us this, that we should do this so that we remain focused throughout the design and development process. So I pinched these examples off MSDN. My travel app is great at helping friends create itineraries collaboratively for group trips. My workout app is great at letting friends track their workout progress. My grocery app is great at helping families coordinate their weekly grocery shopping list so that they never miss or duplicate a purchase again. So what's really interesting about these great at statements is they don't focus on features. They don't list the features that are in your app. Instead, they try to describe the outcome, the end user benefit. And as much as anything, it's a little mini pitch, right? It's how you describe your app to someone if you wanted them to download it. Or if a user loved that app and wanted to tell their friends about it, how would they describe it? I think this is a great little way to start the process of thinking about what your app is for. On bigger projects, we do a lot of analysis about this. But even on the smallest project, you can sort of just do a one sentence description of what your app is great at. Sometimes we say great for, what it's great for. In other words, what its purpose is. And then we use that to determine what the features should be. And most importantly, we use it to throw out features, particularly when we're doing apps. We use it to help us to design, choose between design options. And we also use it, once we've got a user experience in place, to evaluate that and see how we're going. One of the key aspects of this evaluation process is that you are not your user. So as much as when you evaluate your own UX, or when I come to evaluate someone's UX, we have to constantly remind ourselves that we shouldn't be evaluating it from the point of view of us as an end user. And when you're designing your application, the same applies. Even if you're designing an application that's going to be used by people just like you, and Niall actually said in the emails when we were discussing, I tend to design apps that I would use. There's one problem with evaluating an application as if it was for you personally. Does anyone know what it is? Exactly. You've been thinking about it for 6 months, whereas your average punter hasn't. So as best you can, you want to take yourself out of your own shoes and put yourself into the shoes of your real users. Think about what they're trying to achieve, their situation, what they're up to. And we use techniques like personas and scenarios to do that. We won't be covering those today, but I just wanted to make it important. I just wanted to emphasize that important point. So let's get into it. How are we going for time? Okay, so we're gonna have about 10 minutes per app, something like that. And the first one is AU Weather Pro. Nice transition, thank you, Tech Ed Deck. So I asked Niall, what would your great app statement be? He said he hadn't written one. In fact, he said, I'm not one for writing out mission statements on apps. And then he went on to say, it's great at providing accurate and detailed Australian weather information. Not a great app statement, Niall, because it's kind of like that's the features, yeah? And I would have, rather than list what the features are, I would have said, how does it distinguish itself from other weather apps, for example? Is it all about detail? Is it all about glance and go? Is it about being sort of fun and quirky? Given the large number of weather apps that are in the store, how are you going to distinguish yours? These are all Niall's answers. Who's the audience? All Australian Windows Phone users. Once again, I think that's a cop-out. Of course, we're off to a bad start. Of course, you want everyone to use your app, right? But if you don't think about who is the niche market, your app risks not having a personality because it becomes bland, right? It's for everyone. Now, whenever I go into a client meetings and I ask who is your audience, they all say, well, it's everyone. We don't want to exclude anyone. But ironically, the more generic your user interface is, the more bland it is, the more you're likely to exclude people. People want your apps to have a personality, a tone, if you like. Having a particular audience in mind, you don't mind if more people than that audience uses it, but having an audience in mind helps you set a tone. He made a couple of comments about how he goes about the UI. I guess the main point here is that if you've used previous versions of AU Weather Pro, it was much more decorated, and he's pared it back quite a lot. And it was mainly through this, because through store feedback, people saying it doesn't look like it belongs on the platform. And I think this is really important. If you're designing for a particular platform, doesn't matter whether it's Windows or iPhone or whatever, you want to look like you belong. Because people will be much more confident. How does he evaluate his UX? Mainly through feedback from the store, which of course is one of the great benefits of the store is that you have access to constant feedback. And he also says, "Bow, I'm a regular user of my own apps." Let's have a look at it. I want to keep moving. So I might just blank that out. Whoops. I black it out, and then when I go to the emulator, it comes back. Oh well. One more time. Oh well. So here's the icon. And first impressions matter. We're doing the expert review here, so it's just Shane's opinion, right? The logo expresses the function of the app really well, which I think is, a lot of logos don't. I'm not sure why we need AU. Is the map of Australia sufficient, I wonder? Because it's quite a detailed little icon there. There's a lot going on because of those ragged edges. You'll find that some of the best icons, try to keep the edges, horizontal and vertical, try to keep things clean. But nevertheless, it's got a nice outline shape. It's a recognisable shape. We're probably off to a good start. So we're going to launch the app for the very first time. We get a nice little splash screen. And then we get what I'd consider to be a fairly unwelcoming front screen. So what Niall needs to do, of course, is find out where you are so he can give you a forecast. So, I look at this and the first thing I do is I try to work out how information has been sort of clustered and how we expect users to read the screen. So one of the things that I'll do, and you'll see a lot of designers do this, is I'll squint at a screen like this, and what I'm trying to do is just understand the hierarchy of information, what stands out, what doesn't. How does information appear to be grouped? And I don't need to read the words to do that. In fact, it's easier if I can't read the words. One of the problems here is that it's really hard to know where to look. There's an awful lot of text going on, and the text is arguably useful. Firstly, I suggest it's an unfriendly welcome. And secondly, it feels like you know what? Using AU Weather Pro sounds like it's going to be work. Now, if we'd set the tone up front that AU Weather Pro is the super detailed, it's got all the features, it's got, you know, it's for the weather geeks, which it kind of is, then we might have got away with this, right, in terms of the tone. But if the tone was more, you know, it's just everybody's handy weather app, then this one, then, you know, that's potentially off-putting. What he wants us all to do is press the edit settings button, right? And this is all by way of saying, you need to do that. So we won't decompose it now, but, you know, an app like, you know, a page like this needs to, you know, I think, if this is the way you want to go, direct attention more obviously to this. But the other thing I'd think about for an app like this, in order to give people a sense of what they're going to get from the app, I might have just chosen a sample location. A lot of weather apps do that, right? So Niall's based in Melbourne, so we could have started with Melbourne and then clearly indicated how to change that, because it gives you it welcomes you into the app without this sense that, oh, I've got to do a lot of work before I get anything.
Why not start with a map of Australia and just click on it?
Yeah. I think, I mean, a map of Australia, well, that's interesting, right? Because one of the things I was going to mention is that you saw the splash screen go past ever so briefly. It kind of sets a bit of a tone visually, and then we never see that again. And the map might have actually been a way to sort of tie the splash screen to the opening screen. What he's doing here, what he didn't want to do is have a step before the weather screen. So this is actually the weather screen in an error state or an I'm not ready state. So there's a couple of options there. We're going to have to pick somewhere. So we click on edit settings. You know, I got to say, I have the same problem. This is looking like a lot of work. Yeah? He wants us to choose a location for our weather observations, which is different to the forecast itself. We need to choose a radar location and a tide location. Let's accept that we need to choose all those things. Possibly what we want to do here is make you more comfortable about, you know, this process sort of, and one way to do it would be to tease it out into steps so that you didn't feel like, whoa, I've got to fill out a form, you know, but maybe it's more like a wizard. Or with some smarts, maybe he could sort of, you know, once he's got one location, he can use it to determine the others. I'm not sure. I was going to chat with him live, but I think given, I think we need to keep moving. If we do find closest locations, lo and behold, I'm not sure why it's found Melbourne.
Emulator.
Why would the emulator pick Melbourne?
The emulator's separate from the actual coordinates of the computer, so you set it differently.
Have I set the location at some stage, have I?
It's not tied directly to the location of the computer in the emulator.
Right. Oh, okay. Maybe I've probably set the location in the emulator in the past, is what you're saying. Okay, cool. So that kind of, I mean, so that's interesting, right? This kind of worked, solved a lot of the problem that we thought we were going to have. But in terms of the reading, you know, reading down the page, it felt like I was going to have to do all of this before I did that. And unless I read carefully, I didn't realize that this was going to probably solve my problem in most cases. So, you know, people, when we don't work hard enough to direct people's eyes where we want them to look, people will just read top left, bottom right, right? It's how we learnt to read in school. So oftentimes where, you know, so therefore we should lay out our screens top left, you know, left, right, top to bottom. But where we want to direct people's attention in other, you know, somewhere else, then we start playing around with visual weight. Now you could argue that this is quite heavy visually because it's red and bold and it's got an asterisk on it, which is the universal symbol for something's wrong. Or it's mandatory, something maybe. I just feel like even though he's done the right thing to try and make this thing look heavy, I don't know what you guys think, but I think there's so much going on here that this is unable to stand out. And it now that I think about it, it also suffers from the fact that it's perfectly aligned with the content above. Now, the guidelines say that's exactly what we have to do. But what's really interesting is that our brains tell us that things that are aligned are somehow related. Because it's how we, I won't go into the physics of how we process visual information, but we look for that alignment in order to work out if all those shapes are part of the same animal. So our brain subconsciously is saying this is, you know, a continuation of that, and that's telling our brain we're going to have to go through it. So some things we could do there, I guess we should look at some weather. Just checking the time. All right, you tell me.
No idea.
Sorry? Back button on the phone. This is... Where's Nick? Where every app, we argue about the back button on the phone. We don't argue. We decide what to do. Because even Microsoft, let's face it, is a little bit schizophrenic about this. Whether you need an OK and cancel or some sort of confirmation, or whether back is an implied confirmation, or whether back is an implied cancel. In this case, and I'll say, where we don't have to go through the strictest review with Microsoft, we're tending to put explicit buttons on, because I think, you know, the polite thing to do is say, is to just, you know, clearly advertise, this is for saving, this is for deleting, this is for cancelling, whatever, rather than relying on people to use the back button. Because I don't know, I use Windows Phone a lot, and I don't know about you guys, but when I'm in a new app and I'm about to press that back button, I have that moment of anticipation. Am I about to lose all this? Right? In this case, Niall's done the right thing and wants us to press back to get our weather. And now what's interesting is that the screen, the original screen, has now reappeared, now hydrated with actual content. So what do we think about this little screen? Visual hierarchy is mostly really good here, right? You know, we're pointing out, you know, the main stuff here is really easy to spot. You know, it's nice and big and bold. And, you know, he's clearly indicated that, you know, here's the main stuff and here's some other stuff. So I really like that. I think the use of icons is really interesting. Icons, you know, do tend to provide a little bit of character, a little bit of personality for an application. If I was being maybe a little too cruel, I wonder about three identical icons. This one's slightly different, but almost the same. The other thing I would probably do, I presume these are tappable. If they're not tappable, all right, okay. So you can't tap on these guys. Now, square, you know, rectangle of solid color is the Windows Phone and Windows 8, you know, default de facto symbol for tap me, tap me. I would probably consider keep the icons, but lose the tile shape around them. So we're still using them to provide a little bit of variety and some bullet points when you're scanning the app, but let's not trick people into tapping them. All right, we probably need to wrap up on poor old Niall. We need to share the love around, right? What do we think about the tone? I think it's a little harsh.
It's a bit pro, yeah.
Alarming. So what Niall's done is he's picked up the accent colour, so he didn't pick the red, right? That's the phone accent colour coming through, which is another problem. Awesome idea to allow users to customise their phone by choosing an accent colour, but I almost never have been in a situation where I'm like, yeah, the accent colour is welcome in my design, because I don't know what I'm going to get. You know, I don't know if I'm going to get puce or slate or red.
Magenta.
Magenta, right. most of the applications we work with, you know, are quite heavily branded anyway. So when you're doing, you know, when you're doing ticker tech, you know, we can't really find a place for the accent colour anyway. I think where the accent colour is handy is where you don't have a strong brand, and you would argue that this is a case in point. And I wouldn't be saying to Niall that he needs to, you know, fill this with a whole bunch of visual frippery, as we tend to say back at work. But he needs to ask himself, what's the tone? What's the emotion that I want people to get? You know, and if it's geeky, you've got all the stuff, then that's fine. And then think about how he can address that through the icons and the wording. You know, copyright mobilewares.net, I think, is not welcoming as the title of every page. It's kind of a little bit of officious. You know, there's various ways apart from graphics that you can sort of loosen up the visuals here. All right, who's next? I forget. Is it Troy?
It's Troy.
Yeah, come on up, buddy. This is Troy, everyone.
G'day, everyone.
Hi. Round of applause for Troy.
Thank you.
Tell us about your little app, mate.
So a safer web, as Shane said, is the automated security analyzer for ASP.NET websites, which is a mouthful, but in short, the idea is I wanted to create a website where anyone can go along and say, I want to check things like basic security misconfiguration on my app, so I'm going to copy a URL, paste it in, and hit go. So my objective was to get rid of a lot of the barriers that are in place with using security analyzers, such as client installs, such as site ownership verification, which is why everything is pretty low intrusion, if you like. So my objective is just try and make it easy and to give simple feedback and then to show people how they should be doing it.
So I interpret this, you know, this is from Troy's email, make it easy to immediately scan your site is about get me started straight away. And I think this is really interesting because, you know, security, you know, when we talk about tone and personality, you know, security, you know, issues, you know, come with, you know, certain emotions, right? Troy was saying the audience is ASP.NET developers. You know, they're invested in making sure that their sites are secure. So there's an emotional tone already. So we'll switch across to the other machine. I brought my old eyes with me today. All right, well, it said one, but it's not one. I'm just going to try them all until we get it. Number one here, mate.
Yeah, that's this. What's the user experience on these projectors right now?
Let's just talk about that great at statement. You know, making it easy for anyone to quickly assess the security configuration of their ASP.NET website. How do you get that message across? What have you done to tell people that?
Look, a couple of ways, and we'll assume it will work in a moment. We'll see. The first thing is lots of sort of visual indicators. And in fact, do you want to run into that now?
Is that not the starting point?
Well, that's the starting point. So, all right, we'll go from the start. So safeweb.com, and the main thing I wanted to do is just have a freaking massive input box there, which very clearly says, look, this is what you want to do. I don't know, Shane, how well that's come across or not. Maybe it's not quite clear enough for that. I'll need a URL in there now that I look at it.
No, there's a clear single call to action, right? You need to do something in here.
Make it your own website.
I think... Yeah, I mean, you could put... you could? Yeah. I'm actually thinking a step before. And my question is, do I know what I'm getting myself into here? You know what I mean? Have you reassured me that, you know, this is, you know, that I trust you? You know, what am I going to get? Now, the interesting thing is, because I was looking at this yesterday, when I eventually found this was what... So right down the bottom there, it says, try it out with a sample website. And that was the clincher for me. You know, and maybe I'm not in the target audience, but I read, oh, I don't get any of this. All right, you know, here's a safe way for me to try it out. You know, and...
As somebody that's used it, the same thing, I put somebody else's website in before I put...
How'd they go? and that's...
The same thing, you hit the button, that little bit of...
Yeah. That's the grey area. We won't go into that today.
So my question, you know, in a longer session with Troy, my question would be, what is the journey that a user has had before they've arrived here? Because either they've arrived and they know what to expect, or else we've got to use this page to sell that expectation. So how are you promoting it? How are people likely to...
Well, I mean, I guess the first thing is it's not a business for me. It's a hobby project, so it's right. Something that I need to promote and raise revenue out of. So,
well, I think that answers the question. You've got to rely on this page to do all the selling.
That's true.
You know what
I mean? It's just that or word of mouth, and people... I guess you kind of assume that they figure it out, but I see what you're saying. It doesn't kind of lead them in the journey of what to expect and so on.
I can't remember what we decided to do. We're going to use that sample one, or you want to use it?
Well, let's not use SMH. Let's just do the sample.
No, we won't use any. Do
you want me to run that?
So we'll type it in there.
Well, we'll just click on the scan it now button. Actually, maybe that doesn't.
And that's as if I type, that'll be the same effect.
Yeah, so that's the same end result as typing in that other address.
So now I said we're going to do a bit of a heuristic evaluation, and I should have actually, I'm going to flip it back across, sorry, because I should have talked a little bit about what they are. Number 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. There's different people have different lists of sort of heuristics for good design. This is a very old list from the 90s, but it's just got 10 items in it. Some lists are a lot longer. I can't really go through them all right now, but you know, visibility of system status means, do I know what's going on? Match system between system and real world, does it match my experience and expectations from the real world? Does it use language that I'm familiar with? Does it follow a process that I'm familiar with? Do I feel in control of the process? Is it using standards, or is it internally consistent so that I can apply my previous knowledge? Does it help me not make mistakes? Does it not rely on my memory? This one, recognition rather than recall, is one that we don't worry about. We tend to get this right these days, but back in the olden days, you know, applications required me to memorize a whole bunch of stuff. Usually that's not the case. Can I work in different ways? Can I be flexible? Is it attractive, but is it minimalist? In other words, are all the pixels communicating something? When we say minimalist, we don't mean empty necessarily. We mean that all the pixels are doing work. They're communicating. Help me spot when I've made an error, and last resort, make sure that there's a way to get some assistance. So, sorry, Troy, I just wanted to flip back to that. Because when you think about... this page, my first question is, what is the system status? What has just happened? And I know that from, so scan of not a safer web dot blah 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 dot com homepage tells me that a scan has happened, I guess. Yeah?
Yes, correct.
And I would wonder, you know what I might do here? Is I might put a timestamp on there. The timestamp is completely useless information because who cares when the scan happened, but it tells me that the scan just happened.
Sure.
You know what I mean?
Yeah, so this is current status sort
of
stuff.
Yeah, yeah. You can schedule a regular scan. We might look at that in a sec. And then as I scan this page, my eye drops immediately down to the traffic lights down the bottom here, right? And I think that's... Without knowing the content, I think that's probably right, yeah?
Yeah, it is, but it's interesting you say that because just as I was looking at this, it's funny how you see things when they're really big. I think all this information, which is trying to say, look, these are the requests that were made in order to get to that status, and my mind's kind of going a little bit sequential, chronological, I think this is probably the really important bit, and I wonder how much relevance that has in sort of prime position.
So what you're trying to say to the reader is, I did this, 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 and my conclusion is this.
Yeah.
Well, so the sequence makes sense, right?
I guess this is the value, you know, this is the, when you see red, it's bad kind of thing.
I wonder whether, because I think I would keep that at the bottom because it, you know, we're talking about reading order, it shows that this stuff happened and then this is the conclusion, right? But I wonder whether coming back to the timestamp, maybe instead of the timestamp or as well as the timestamp, you might summarise this.
Yeah, right.
Three,
so like
okay, two.
Roll it up into. Well,
yeah.
Yeah, okay.
So you sort of get a headline result.
Yeah.
Then you see this is how we did it, and here's more information about it, right?
Yeah, right.
Are these clickable, these guys?
Yeah, so as we click these, we jump down into more detail. So if we go into something like stack traces, we'll jump down to detail of what the scan was, how it caused a stack trace, so you get a requested URL and you get response details. And then sort of a bit of an overview, here's how to fix it, here's how to go and read more information about it. So the intention is to try and give people everything they need there to understand the process of causing the exception and then how to go and fix it.
Yep. And this that was an anchor link, right? It scrolled down the page.
Correct.
Okay. Did everyone spot that? Yeah, cool. Sometimes one of the problems with anchor links is that people get lost. They think they've gone to a new page when they've, in fact, gone down. But short of doing, you know, a whizzy accordion where you expand and collapse in place, which is probably the best way to try and relate this information to the heading, but, you know, that's extra work, makes reasonable sense. And in terms of the visual hierarchy here, stack trace fail. I think what I would probably want to do is reproduce the exact red... what
like
do you call
solid
that?
Background.
No, the red rectangle with the message that we saw at the top.
Okay, okay.
I'd reproduce it exactly here, so that visually I'm like, yeah, that's the thing I was just looking at.
Right, so it was like that big blocky red background with fail in there.
Just the one tile that you clicked on, right?
Yeah.
I'd reproduce that here to just create some visual continuity from one to the other.
I hope someone's taking notes for me so I remember this.
I think these are being recorded, so you can...
Awesome.
You can come back later. Any other comments about this one before we move on? Right. Yeah, that's a good point. Because you've gone down, you need to get back up. And unless you've been very clever, back won't work, right?
I think it's an anchor, so it should work.
Oh, there you go. But nevertheless, did you know, I guess?
I guess it depends on whether you know it's an anchor and whether you know what the anchor behaviour is.
Yeah. This is interesting. We're seeing a lot more use of animation and transitions in applications, web and native, for exactly that reason, to help sort of people build a mental map of how the application hangs together. Requires a lot more thought on the part of design and also requires a lot more code as well, or at least more code. But it seems to be there was a day when we hated animation, right? You know, any kind of movement on the screen was considered bad because we'd all been burnt by flaming, rotating logos. But nowadays we use animation for good rather than for evil. Mate, I'm going to leave it there. I know that there was another thing we're going to look at, but we might have to skip that.
Right, thanks very
much.
Everyone,
Troy.
Thanks, guys.
What's really switch back, Shane. What's really good about I didn't really get to do much heuristic evaluation, but you know, one of the advantages of a heuristic evaluation versus just an expert evaluation is that anyone can read through that checklist, right? And so, what I'd normally do, just coming back to the checklist, is you know, if I had a day to do heuristic evaluation, I'd look at every screen and I'd say to myself, is it clear what the system status is? Is it clear, or is there a clear match between, you know, in terms of terminology and workflow and stuff, between what happens in the real world and what's happening in the application? Does the user feel like they're in control? Which doesn't always mean they have freedom, by the way. But, you know, what's really important is that the user feels like they're driving the experience. So when we think about back to that first opening page, you know, that was really the cause of my concern. I'm about to type my URL in here, but I don't know what's going to happen. So that's a user control issue. So as I said, one of the advantages of these heuristic evaluations is you don't necessarily have to be an expert, but they're probably better with an expert who's done it before. The other problem is that they're not domain specific, right? They're just testing general rules of good design rather than anything specifically about your users or your business. So, candidate number three, roof of delivery. Good one, Shane. Proof of delivery. So Ed's got a little app in a little light switch app, actually, which we'll flip across to in just a sec. What we're going to do, what I'll try to do for at least for a few minutes is this idea of what's called a cognitive walkthrough. I'll talk about that in a sec. I'll talk about that now. So the way the cognitive walkthrough works, big words, but basically what it means is we think about what's going on in the user's head at each step. And so, you know, the questions are a little bit highfalutin, but at each step, does the user know what they are required to do next? Can the user see the action, the matching action on the screen? In other words, so that's what is the correct action apparent? Can I spot the thing that will let me do the thing I want to do? Do they recognize it as such? And when they've done it, this is the important thing, will they be confident they've done the right thing? So has everyone got those four steps in their heads? I'll flip across. Tell us a bit about your app, Ed.
Okay, so the app is part of a huge solution, I guess, and the solution is all about supply chain management, freight logistics. It covers pickup of goods and delivering those goods to the stores through a network of national carriers.
Okay, so we're going to walk through a specific task, right? We're going to imagine that, you were telling me this morning, we're going to imagine that I'm working at the back at the office. Some delivery driver has just dropped off some stuff.
The background around this task is that someone at the carrier level needs to confirm that delivery has happened, and they need to confirm who signed for it, when it happened, because that affects their performance indicators, and the performance indicators affects the fact that they're getting paid.
So I'm going to tell myself.
It's pretty important.
Yeah. So in order to put myself in the user's shoes, I'm imagining I'm sitting back at some warehouse or some back office somewhere. Driver has showed up with a pile of delivery dockets.
You need to get through the pile.
I've got a pile of delivery dockets in front of me. Well, I've got one. I've got the number of it here in front of me. And I need to go to the system and say that stuff has been delivered.
Right.
So, you know, back to the cognitive walkthrough. You know, do I know what I need to do? Yeah, I know what I need to do. I need to confirm delivery of this thing. Can I find a matching item on the screen here that that reassures me that I've found the right thing?
Now, in logistics, people know what POD means.
Right. I was going to say that, right? So it relies on a little bit of domain knowledge.
They all call it POD.
And that's another reason why, you know, getting an expert review in, you know, may not, you know, you need to be on the lookout for things. So we'll take your word for it. You know, as a user, I would know what a POD is, a proof of delivery. Yep. And so you want me to press on consignment POD, right?
Right.
So question one, do I know what I want to do? Yes. Question two, is the correct action apparent? Yep, it's this guy here.
Question three, why is it not rendering correctly?
Yeah, let's leave him off. Let him off the hook on that one.
That's Microsoft's fault.
Oh, there you go.
It's a SharePoint site.
So if we... Did you just click on it?
Yep.
So the question four is, will I know that I've done the right thing? Okay. So I've clicked on proof of delivery. I've arrived at a screen here, and a couple of things come immediately to mind. The thing that I clicked on, consignment POD, is nowhere on this screen. So it's a really simple way that we can connect the action with the response. It's just to bring, you know, we talked.
It's on the right.
Oh, over there?
It's behind those three dots.
Are we going to believe him? Well, we'll believe you.
But it's a good point, because one of the reasons we decided to go with light switch and not a regular ASP.NET web app is because we were hoping that that would make it real easy for us to deploy this on a number of devices and a number of screen sizes and those types of things without us really having to do any work on that. But apparently that's not the case.
Do I really have the... Am I willing to try that? I don't know how to scroll on this thing. I wasn't even going to attempt it. There you go, more or less. Cool. So I'm looking for that feedback, clear feedback at the top that says you've gone to the place that you want to go. And then I'm looking, I can see a whole bunch of yellow stuff, which is data, I think, although the yellow makes me think I can click on it. I'm now going to see if I can. Apparently I can. And I see a bit of a menu up the top there, pick up, delivery, delivered, authorized payment. Now, if this was a single-use application, I'd be arguing that that menu needs to pop out more because, you know, it's really going to... It drives the rest of the screen. But in terms, I presume, that you pick on the...
Yes, yep. Absolutely, yeah. Those are taps.
Yep. But because of the visual weight takes you straight to the data here, you know, if this was a walk-up and use like a kiosk, I'd be worried that people wouldn't get that connection. Mm. But because this is an app that people are going to use a lot, the data tends to be more important than the navigation. Yep. So I'd probably let you off the hook in this case because people will find their way to the navigation when they're ready. So now I know for a fact that what you want me to do here is navigate, right?
Well, you're going for a proof of delivery, right?
Exactly.
So you want the deliveries instead of the pickups, because otherwise it would be a pickup.
So I remember my training when I started this job.
Actually, it's interesting you say that, because what I was really surprised about was the adoption was really quick.
Right.
Where you just show someone a few minutes and they go, yep, we got it, and it's done.
Awesome.
That was nice. Yeah.
So if we come back to the cognitive walkthrough, do I know what I need to do? Yes, I still need to confirm that this thing was delivered. Is the correct action apparent? What you're asking of me, and I might flip around here. I could go for search consignment number, but what we want to do is delivery up the top. So I think it's apparent.
Sorry?
Why didn't we go straight to delivery?
Yeah. Well, no, look, the app, it evolved. The app was only deliveries initially, but they wanted pickups as well.
So proof of delivery is a little bit pickups. Misleading now.
Yeah, it is, yeah.
That's interesting. I didn't even spot that. Thank you.
But in light switch, you can actually set it to start at that page.
Okay.
Yeah, but we don't know that that's what the user wants to do. Right? But like I said, the POD could also be about a pickup. It could be either a pickup or a delivery.
It could be a proof of pickup?
Yeah.
I like probably what we should have two tiles up the front, one for POD and one for pickup.
That's interesting. You could have a more task-oriented, you could break this down into more tasks, I guess, that navigate to the individual sections.
Yeah.
I think one of the problems with that, I would do it. But one of the concerns that I would have is that you've now created two navigations. There's a set of options here.
So it's interesting that you say that, because I did put a bit of thought in that, and it's mainly role-based. So typically we've grouped the stuff that typically sits on the same desk for the same person. So that person does pickups and deliveries.
Mm.
And that's why it's their app.
Cool.
Sounds like just an ambiguous sort of term.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That everyone in the business knows that POD doesn't just mean delivery.
Yeah.
It's just how it's evolved.
Right. Yeah.
That's correct.
Yeah. And this, obviously, this reveals one of the downsides of getting an external person in to review your UI, because either I have to have this conversation and take Ed's word for it to a certain extent, or I'm likely to spot things that don't necessarily apply to a specific audience. Let's just go back in. So I'm going to click on delivery. And now my task is I've got PTS 3238 here, and I need to confirm that it was delivered. So I can see all the numbers there, and so I'm now faced with a bit of a choice. Shall I scan down the list or shall I search? There's no indication of how big the list is. I know for a fact that I'm going to spot it because it's only the third one down, but generally speaking, I guess there's two options there, right? What would you normally recommend to them, search or scan?
Well, they typically have like a day's worth of work, so they'll be on the page typically.
Right.
Page in the sense of within the next 20 to 40 rows, something like that. But that's why we've got the filtering mechanism and the search mechanism, so they can zoom into
they can decide for themselves,
what they need to do. And the other one we wanted to add is, like in SharePoint, sorting and filtering on the headers, but if anyone knows how to do that in light switch,
no. Cover that in the break.
I have without, some money for you.
without going into too much detail, I think what I'd be curious about is I'd probably want to see the work environment, because my question in my mind is whether this search should actually be front and center and not behind a click. Because if I've got a stack of these forms, am I just going to type, find, type, find, type, find, or am I going to scroll through the list?
Good point. I'll check that. I get that.
Listen, the light switch session is at lunchtime, dude.
Yeah, we'll do that, Glenn.
We need to finish
the other,
up.
The other one I'm very curious about is, you know, they're clickable, and the clicking means there's the actions there that become available in those rows.
Yep.
And I'm wondering if that's too much hidden.
But look, I don't think so.
Anyone knows as soon as they've done it once, they'll remember.
So there's that.
And that's the.
I think, you know, and in the absence of anything else to do, people are going to click it anyway.
Yeah.
You know, so, you know, I talked about visibility and confidence, but here's a case where I'd be thinking, particularly because people will have had at least a little bit of training, you know, that, you know, there's nothing else I can do with this thing until I click it, so I might as well click it.
Yeah.
Yeah?
Okay.
So I'm going to confirm delivery and then we're done. Now, how will I confirm delivery? Oh, there you go. So we might normally be worried about the rollover, particularly if we're doing a touch-based app. But once again, because this is an app people are using day in, day out, you might argue that we shouldn't fill the thing with labels, as long as the icons are really easy to spot, we should be in business. And now I'm supposed to, you don't want me to do this part, but...
No, just don't press update.
Yeah. now I enter some information off the form. So in terms of that mapping, that cognitive mapping, I pressed on the delivery confirmation. I got a dialogue that is called delivery confirmation. That's much better mapping. I worked through the form from top to bottom. I hit update at the end. No, I don't. And I'm good to go. That was our mini cognitive walkthrough.
And the row then disappears from view, and it actually turns up in the delivery tab.
Oh, cool. Okay, so I get a little bit extra feedback as well. Awesome. That's it. That was pretty easy.
Thanks, mate.
Everyone, thank Ed. Oh, I forgot the chocolates for our volunteers. Whoa, sorry, buddy. I need one more volunteer. Yes. I think, like I said, if it's an app that people aren't going to use regularly, then yeah, we go the extra mile to communicate what you can do and where you should click. If it's an app that people are like a line of business app that people are using a lot, we usually decide that we don't want to actually distract people with a whole bunch of stuff that they've just learnt. You know what I mean? And we'd rather focus on data than controls, you know, content over Chrome. So the answer is in that balance between is this an occasional use app or a regular use app? Is how much effort we'd spend advertising what you can do. Does that make sense? All right, we've only got 10 minutes left to do our last little test. So the advantage of a cognitive walkthrough compared to the heuristic evaluation or the expert evaluation is, as you saw, we're focusing on the sequence of steps, whereas the other workflows other evaluations treat each screen as a separate screen. This sort of evaluation focuses more on can people find their way through the application. And the last type of evaluation is to cop out altogether and get someone else to do the work for you, and that's what we call a usability test. So we're going to have a look at Andrew's Find a Word application. He gave us a bunch of background, which I might come back to. But once again, a really crappy great at statement. My app is the best app for playing Find a Word. Awesome. So once again, I just want to emphasize, you want to think about why you're... I mean, there's a bunch of Find a Word applications in the marketplace. How is yours different? Does it solve a particular problem?
So you would say something like train your brain and spend some time or stuff.
You could do it that way, or you might just pick something that you think is unique about your finder word. You know, maybe it's the sharing, or it's
filling in 5 minutes.
Sorry? There you go. That's ripper, right? You know, a specific need. It fills that idle 5 minutes. Awesome. Thanks, David. We might come back to these because I want to run a little usability test. And the way this works is rather than me use the application as an expert, we get a real user and we ask them to perform sample tasks. And we get them to think aloud as they go. And the real key here is for us not to prompt, not to interfere, but to let the user be themselves and see where they go, okay? So this is the three, four techniques, this is the only one that really puts us in the user's shoes because we get users to do the evaluation for us effectively. So yes, you're right, I'm looking for a volunteer. You get Ferrero Rocher, if that helps, firsthand. Stephen, I'm Shane, how are you going? We've never met before, right?
No, never.
Cool.
Except for last night.
Right. Nothing up my sleeve. What we're going to get you to do, you're going to have to... We're going to get you... And Matt's freaking out because I didn't tell him that I had an extra guest speaker because, Matt, I forgot. Apologise. But he's just going to speak loud. He'll be fine. What we're going to do is use Andrew's app, Find the Word. What I want you to do... Well... Let me just firstly brief you. So thanks for coming along for this usability test, Stephen. It'll take about 15 minutes. It's not a test of you. It's a test of the people who've designed the application. So there's no wrong answers.
Okay.
Normally I'd go into this in a bit more detail. But you know what? We're not trying to find out whether you can use applications. We're trying to find out whether this application is good for you.
Okay.
And what I'm going to ask you to do is use the application as you go. Sorry, buddy.
Sorry. It's just been...
What I'm going to do is use the application and sort of think aloud as you go, yeah? Tell me
okay.
What you're thinking.
Yep.
Yeah? So starting here, how would you start the Find a Word application?
Well, go into apps and open it up, I suppose.
And tell me what, before you do it, tell me what you would do.
To try and find that app.
No, to start it.
Oh, to start it. Click on it.
Okay, cool.
Okay.
You can use your fingers, it's a touchscreen.
Oh, okay.
So tell me what
okay.
you just describe to me what you see describe to me what you see.
Well, we've got available there. We've got get more, I would assume, further on the right there. A free starter pack, 10 free puzzles. To get started. Does that mean this is going to charge me for more packs?
What do you think?
I suspect so.
Okay.
It's a free starter pack, which means it's paid for somewhere else. There's also no
okay.
option to pay
I'm
for anything.
Taking else. Notes at this point.
let's see. We've got a free starter pack. I'm not entirely sure what exactly it's what to click on, whether that's clickable or not. Sorry, am I? I've been muted.
So you're not sure.
I'm not sure
what to click
on next.
Okay.
It's got a box around it, so I would assume it's clickable.
Before you do.
Okay.
How do you feel about the application at this point?
Neither here nor there. It's black and white text on black screen. So. It's got no real personality as far as I'm concerned.
Okay, cool. Do you think this application is designed for someone like you? That was not meant to imply that Stephen has no personality. That was a great example of what can go wrong
reading.
In these sessions. Sorry?
I have difficulty reading, so find a word probably not good for me.
Oh, okay.
English is not my strong suit. I'm a developer.
Right. Well, we could say the same thing about Coetzee. What would you do next?
Well, I suppose I'd click on the free starter pack.
Okay. What do you expect to happen? He wants to tap, and
I want to tap it.
Yeah.
It's going to take me to another screen. Don't think it's going to take me to the get more screen. I have absolutely no idea where I'm going to go from here.
Okay.
Hopefully, some kind of level selection. Perhaps,
okay.
From experience with other games.
Okay, let's find out.
Okay. Ah, there we go. What
is
I expected.
Is that what you expected?
That is what I expected. Level selection.
Cool.
There are three boxes that we've got. There are three levels that are visible. And the what looks like the white borders on the bottom there of more levels. So from that I can guess it's scrollable.
So this little guy down here,
this tiny little white line here, is telling me there's actually more stuff.
Cool.
If I were to be designing this, I suppose I'd like to show that there was more stuff, add a scroll bar perhaps,
right,
or shrink the size of those so that you can actually see 3.5. And therefore, you know there are more.
Right, yeah. Just stop right there. So often we get this happens in usability tests where the user, you know, wants to help out and starts offering design solutions.
Yeah.
And sometimes those design solutions are awesome. There's no doubt about it. But what we always try to do is get to what's behind that suggestion. You know, what's your actual concern? We may solve it a different way, but what I'm most interested in is what Stephen's concern is. What are you going to do next, mate?
Probably scroll down the list, see if I've got those 10 free puzzles that I was promised
did
in
you
the
get
first
your,
grade.
Did you get your value for money? Okay,
yeah.
Let's do that.
All right. Yeah? Up? No, was not expecting that. That was sliding left and right. There we go. Okay, I would assume that if I was sliding to the right, I would go to the summary, but not necessarily that this was going to continuously rotate, I suppose. That's
right.
My inexperience with Windows phones.
See, and that's another thing we often get. Oh, I'm just not experienced, right? Fact is, that's the real person, right? You know, I might not have spotted that problem because I'm used to mucking around with these pivots in Windows Phone. When we get real users in, we discover all sorts of interesting things. We're going to have to wrap up, Stephen. What would you do next?
Well, if I want to actually play one of these puzzles, I'll click on the puzzle itself. And there we go.
Did you get what you expected?
Yep, pretty much.
Can you put in a guess for me? Put in sort.
Oh, I expected that to auto-submit.
Ah, that's interesting. Okay. You may now have your Ferrero shoes.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Everyone, thanks, Stephen. So we're out of time. I just want to quickly wrap up. You can see that there were different strengths and weaknesses for those different techniques, yeah? Expert review has the least structure, but requires the most expertise. A heuristic review has more structure because you have that checklist. And so particularly if you're not used to doing these sorts of evaluations, it's a great way for you to sort of step through your application screen by screen and just ask yourself, you know, have I made it clear to users, you know, have I helped prevent users making errors, etc. Cognitive walkthrough, is not what we generally never start with a cognitive walkthrough. It's usually in addition to the first two, and particularly where we suspect that there may be problems with that sequence, the workflow, as we call it, then we might sort of, stop and do a cognitive walkthrough. And we do that for, like, the key scenarios. You probably don't do the cognitive walkthrough for every single scenario, but the most common scenarios or the mission-critical scenarios are the ones you might do a cognitive walkthrough. The other advantage of cognitive walkthrough is it's a big word and it's very impressive for customers and stakeholders. Usability test is really the gold standard. It requires a lot more preparation. You know, we did a very quick and dirty one here today. But, you need to find users. Sometimes you need to, you need to be able to, because you want fresh users, you need to have a continuous supply of users. On some of our applications, we do usability tests every 2 weeks. So we actually schedule in advance users who are going to come in. We don't even know what we're going to test for each of those things, but we schedule them in advance. They come to visit us every 2 weeks, and we test whatever we have. But the real key to usability testing is that you take yourself out of the picture and you let a real user use the application and you observe, and you try as hard as you can not to interfere, not to influence them, which is really hard because it's so tempting to just go, you ask them to print something, right? And they're staring at the screen, they're staring at the screen, they're staring at the screen, and it's so tempting not to say, what do you think the print button would do? You've got to remember that if they can't see it, it's not there. And I'll tell you what, if you're struggling to convince your bosses or your team members that there are usability issues, usability test is the best way to do it, because as an expert, you can wave your hands around and complain, but the most compelling, you know, argument is to videotape even a real user really using your application, and that's how you'll get real cut through if usability is an issue. I've run slightly over time, guys. I really appreciate it. I will be around. I'm doing an interview at the Dev Den, but more importantly, if you guys want me to have a look at your app here at TechEd, I will not do 100 of these, but find me on Twitter, Shane Mo, and you know, and maybe around down at the Dev Den, you know, happy to sit down and look at, spend 15 minutes looking at your app. I love to criticize. Okay, it's lunchtime. See you guys.